Azure Echo and organizes AICTE. So this is really, I'm fortunate to talk to you about the work I have been doing for the last, you can say, on this aspect for 10, 15 years. So I have been given this topic, technologies and methods for soil organic carbon assessment. On this chart, actually, I will be talking about what we have been doing or we are doing on working on, you know, on Madhya Pradesh mostly. My work will be limited to Madhya Pradesh, central India. So how, because I know most of you are engineer, but you'll get to have some knowledge about from this presentation about, you know, how actually our soil is just seen, even it is a source of soil carbon and carbon dioxide. So so my presentation will be on cropping systems and soil management practices on soil carbon sequestration and under changing climate scenarios in Madhya Pradesh. So my presentation will be in this format. You will have a basic concept of what is soil organic carbon and what's importance in climate change mitigation, how it helps. Then what are those methodologies of soil carbon assessment, what methodology you follow, and what methodology I have followed to give you this presentation or from output of the research work we have been conducting or we are doing. And to quantify the effect of cropping systems, that's what actually you will see, and soil management practices on soil organic carbon, and under future climate scenarios also, and what are those sustainable management practices that will improve soil organic carbon. So before you start, so it's a basic concept actually. What is soil organic carbon? You said it is soil in organic carbon, means carbon in organic form in soil. So what is that actually? It is the heterogeneous mixture of anything you add into the, you'll have a graphic after this, materials including trace litter, carbohydrates, simple carbohydrates, sugar, you know, soluble in soil solution, as well as complex organic compounds, some inert materials. So pyrogenic compound, just like biochar you were talking about. So this is also to the process of pyrolysis, you know, you get that. So soil organic carbon concentration along with quality and dynamic is essential for diverse soil functions, because without soil carbon, we cannot talk about soil fertility. You might be knowing a little bit of knowledge or understanding about soil fertility. If your soil is fertile, it will give you good crop yield. And if the soil is healthy, then it gives many ecosystem services, and even your drinking water will be that, you know, pure. So diverse functions in the soil, you know, carbon is a source of energy, you know, for the microbes. And without microbes, we cannot think of anything in this world. So they are everything, you know, because of microbes, we are here. Otherwise, you know, all those processes that's happening inside the soil is governed by the microbes. So because of presence of soil organic matter or organic carbon, because of source of energy for them, they do, you know, different nutrient cyclings. You know, for plants, we need nitrogen, all essential elements like nitrogen, phosphorus, sulfur, calcium, magnesium. These are all essential micronutrients like copper, iron, manganese, zinc. No, these are all essential nutrients for plant growth, and because of presence of carbon, because of microbes, we many essential nutrient cyclings that is happening inside soil. And it's interesting to know that soil is an organic carbon mediated domain in which solid, liquid, and gaseous phase interact in a scale ranging from nanometers to kilometers and create dynamic environment conducive to growth and development that I mentioned, and other biota. So all biological activity that is happening inside the soil, the presence of carbon, and that's why we call soil is a living matter or living entity. It is not dead, it's not dirt. Soil is, you know, one spoon of soil have millions of microbes present in it. And soil organic matter, which is comprising, you know, about 50 to 45 to 60% mass of soil organic carbon, is the principal source of energy for soil microbes that I already told. So this is the basic concept about soil organic carbon. And if I give you this flow chart and I'll tell you that what is soil organic, soil carbon, I'm talking about soil organic carbon. If it's soil carbon, it can be two parts. You can see, I was talking about this part, soil organic carbon. Even an important part is also soil inorganic carbon. So total is soil carbon. And soil carbon, if you see only 3 meter soil depth, you will have 6,000 petagram of carbon in this world. So if I break into two parts, one is soil organic carbon, which is very much important for agriculture, and we are more concerned about this than that. So when it is soil organic carbon, there are two types. As I mentioned earlier, one is dissolved organic carbon or soluble sugar or soluble carbohydrates that's in soil solution, and one is in a solid phase. In solid phase, this carbon can be protected or unprotected. So you must be knowing that soil is part of, you know, sand, silt, and clay fraction. So protection is given by this clay and fine silt fractions. And unprotected parts means that is subjected to decomposition by microbes very easily. Protected means microbial decomposition, activity of microbes on this part, because you know that it's source of energy for them, they will act on it. So we want to give protect to the soil organic carbon. That means your soil is clay and fine texture soil or silt content is high. There's every chance that you can protect your soil organic carbon by these means, physical, chemical, biological, ecological means. And that means the clay and fine silt fraction will help you protecting the soil organic carbon. If it's unprotected, means it's contained the coarse silt and sand fraction that carbon attached to it. So this is very much subjected to decomposition. But when you talk about the inorganic part, there can be two parts. One is dissolved bicarbonates, another is solid carbonate. Dissolved carbonates that will be in the soil solution leads to the groundwater with rain, but or maybe irrigation water. But if there is it light textured soil, then if it is a solid carbonate, then it may be lithogenic or pedogenic, primary or secondary. But secondary is important for us. It will give all those calcium carbonate, bicarbonate, sodium, magnesium. So these are all present in the soil. They are part of the inorganic soil carbonate. So my topic will be on this part, where we'll be talking about how soil carbon is helpful to us and how we can improve through different management practices and what are the techniques I have used to map the whole soil of Madhya Pradesh, having different nutrient management practices, because it's agriculture, you all are engineer, but definitely when you sow a crop, you give different types of management practices, nutrients, we feed the plant so that we get a good crop yield. So that's what actually I'll be talking about. You know the many crops in and around Bhopal also, soybean, wheat, maize, chickpea. So we are talking about, I'll be talking about this, how this cropping system will also affect soil carbon in the system. So moving to the next slide, that's what actually I am going to give you the picture of the graphical representation of soil organic carbon. You can see where you get the soil organic carbon. So first have a look at this through the climate, with the rainfall, temperature, and carbon dioxide concentration in the atmosphere. You'll find the plant growth, and through the littered airfall and organic residues, or maybe root exudates coming out of the plants, that will subject it to microbial decompositions and enzymatic activity, and that gives you the soil organic carbon. And even from the external sources of application of manures and compost or crop residues, whatever you are, through microbial decomposition also, it is part of the soil organic carbon. And what you get, actually in soil organic carbon, we bring it to three different poles. One is very labile, means easily available to the microbes. That means this dissolved organic carbon that I have mentioned here. Then one is SWSC, hot water soluble. This is the method of extraction. That's why it is known as hot water soluble carbon. When you add soil to the hot water, then definitely what are the soluble components of carbon coming out of that? And you estimate that that becomes the hot water soluble carbon. That's very labile, easily available to the microbes, and it will be decomposable. You know the simple sugar like carbohydrate or any other parts. Next is labile. It is particulate organic carbon, microbial biomass carbon, means microbes, all those living organisms, that microbes, just like bacteria, fungi, actinomycetes, so all those, and mineral occluded carbon. These are also part of labile carbon. And there are recalcitrant or maybe stable, it's called humus, which is most important part of the soil organic carbon. That means they are resistant to decomposition, more this humus is there in your soil, that is which and your carbon content, you know, you are sequestering more carbon to the soil. So we always target those management practices which can improve these two fractions, because their residence time and their stay in the soil is much more years. I'll come to that in the next slide. You'll find that. So these three fractions, they're physical protected and non-physical protected also, that I already mentioned in the previous slide, how they're physically protected. And they're also subjected to leaching loss or by erosion through surface runoff, or maybe leaching loss when they are soluble in water, there are the soil is light texture, having more sand content, that every chance that it will leach down to the profile. So this is a basic, I think you got a good idea how what is soil organic carbon and how they are present in the soil and what are those components in soil organic carbon and which component we are targeting when you go for our management practices. So that's what actually all those components I mentioned in previous slides, you'll see that that fraction is digital organic matter or digital carbon, then particulate organic matter, then humus, and more resistance one, and look at those turnover times. So digital organic carbon is very easily digestible and decomposed by, these are simple sugars or decomposition byproducts. So minutes to a few days, they're in the soil. So they're very labile. And next is the particulate organic matter. Its resistance time is 2 to 50 years, depending upon the types of materials and quality of the material, the structure present in the material. And next is humus, where you target that is 10 to 100 years. So formation of humus takes that much time. So the turnover time, that's also helpful for us to improve the soil organic carbon pools. This is one pool of the soil organic carbon. Then resistance, it is 100 years to 1,000 years. And their resistance means they're not inert material and microbes don't act on it. So by the time, so you are talking of biochar, so you get many inert material because microbes don't act on those type of materials. So that's why adding biochar sometimes lead to improve your soil organic carbon sequestration. Next is the role of soil organic carbon in climate change and food security. So when you talk about soil organic carbon, definitely we are talking about soil health and fertility and ecosystem services that I mentioned earlier and food production. So making its preservation and restoration essential for suitable development, because without soil carbon, we cannot think of soil health and fertility. When you can't think of soil health and fertility, don't think of soil productivity. So we don't get good yield unless otherwise your soil is good at in carbon. Even in climate change scenarios, with negative impacts on agriculture, farmers need to produce, look at this, 60% more food by 2050 because the population will swells to 9 billion. So we have to improve food production by 60%. That means to meet these needs, soil need to be as productive as possible. That's what actually most important thing is, that to make the soil more productive, we think about carbon. And carbon means not inorganic, it is the organic carbon I'm talking about. So soils with high carbon content like to be more productive, that I mentioned, and better able to filter and purify water. And water stored in the soil serves as source of 90% of world's agriculture production and represents 65% of fresh water. So how important carbon in food security and climate change, you can imagine in that way. And next is carbon plays bigger role in climate change, presenting both threat and opportunity. Because why did I say threat? Because you know methane production and methane, carbon is the source of methane production. When the soil is rich in carbon and there is stagnation of water on anaerobic condition fuels, that time there is formation of methane. And that's why it is a threat. But we can reduce that threat to opportunity by suitable management practices. Because we know that rice soils, because you need submergence for those soils, that's threat to, you know, methane, that's threat to carbon, just a threat for us. But with suitable management practices, we can reduce the methane level. I'll give you an example what type of management practices we can follow. If you are stagnating, then you are creating an environment that is anaerobic condition suitable for, you know, methane production. But what management practices, you go for aerobic rice cultivation or maybe direct seed of rice. You don't go for puddling. So in that case, you are not creating that environment like stagnation of water. And alternate wetting and drying condition also makes, you know, methane production less, you know, is lower than methane production. So the management practice, so that means the carbon threat we can make is opportunity, that because we are utilizing carbon. And carbon is always beneficial, as I mentioned. So it's a threat as well as opportunity, but we have to convert the threat to opportunity. So, you know, the first meter of soil in the globe, I talked about 6 meters having 6,000 petagram of carbon, total carbon I was talking about. But you can see that 1 meter depth also having 1,417 gigatons of carbon, almost double the amount in our atmosphere and dozen times the level of man-made emissions each year. So how much important, once you store the carbon in soils, that means you are mitigating the impact of carbon climate change. So at greater depth, soil holds 3 times as much carbon as the atmosphere. So how much soil is important so far as sink for carbon. So soil carbon is sensitive, how soil is managed, that's what actually your management practices decides whether you can hold more carbon in soil or not. So poor management practices cause soil to lose organic matter and release greenhouse gases. So your management practice is important, and it will tell you whether your system is carbon sink or carbon source. Similarly, if you degrade, you know, already degraded lands, one third of soil is already degraded and or released up to 78 gigatons of carbon to the atmosphere. So through the, you know, through the process of deforestation and anthropogenic activities, and further damage to the soil carbon stock through poor land management practices would hamper the efforts of limit global temperature rise in this century. So it is likely that more carbon will be lost to the atmosphere than be sequestered in process of climate change, resulting in land carbon climate feedback loop that could further accelerate climate change. So soil organic carbon or total carbon, you can say soil carbon is very much important, and soil plays important role in storing the carbon. So it has a tremendous application, you know, soil organic carbon mitigating the climate change effect. So when we talk about soil organic carbon, definitely we talk about soil carbon sequestrations. So what is sequestration? What is this process? It is the process in which soil in which carbon dioxide is removed from the atmosphere and stored in the soil carbon pools. That pools I was talking about, there are three different pools. I told you, labile, very labile, and more inert, the humus pool. So we want to bring those carbon dioxide through the process of, maybe you can say, by growing plants, photosynthesis, trap those carbons, and through that plants it will go to the soil. And this process is primarily mediated by plants. Definitely, plant is the biggest source of carbon capture, and through photosynthesis with carbon stored in the form of soil organic carbon. In arid and semi-arid regions, soil carbon sequestration can occur through inorganic forms, as I mentioned in that flow diagram, as secondary carbonates. However, the rate of inorganic carbon formation is compared low as compared to soil organic carbon. So the process is that we have to improve the pools of carbon. That means less mobile or labile, and more resistant fraction we should increase so that we can store more carbon in the soil. So if I'm talking about soil carbon sequestration, what are those measurements, processes we follow? Definitely, when I talk about the soil in the laboratory conditions, so my presentation will be based on this also, some of the techniques I have followed. In the laboratory, we have wet digestion technique. We called it potassium permanganate acid digestion. So with that, actually, we try to find out what is organic carbon content of the soil. And we can go for also dry combustion techniques. You can take the soil, the analyzers are available, like CEHN analyzer, or maybe just burning the soil, dry combustion. Simple burn the soil and see how much carbon loss there. And through mass balance, you can see how much carbon. That is called dry combustion. And there are different instruments like your total organic carbon or total carbon analyzer. You have CHN analyzer, carbon, hydrogen, nitrogen analyzer. These, you know, these instruments directly can, you can get the carbon content of the soil. Or you can go for DRS, that is diffuse reflectance spectroscopy. You are also working on this to estimate soil organic carbon in soils. That means near infrared and mid infrared spectroscopy we can use and find out what is the carbon content in the soil. Then there are others like LIBS, laser induced breakdown spectroscopy, and also, when you cover talk about the field condition, we follow these principles or these methods. But when you talk about ecosystem services, we go for two approaches. One is AD covariance, another is life cycle assessment in agriculture. And when you go for regional scale measurement, that time we need modeling and soil organic carbon models or agriculture system models. Based on these measurements and techniques, we go for a spatial distribution of soil organic carbon through suitable techniques. And in this case, modeling will help us on estimating the carbon balance or carbon stock or carbon change on a large scale or on regional scale or a country scale. So based on this, I want to show you how we have done for the state Madhya Pradesh and what are those methods we have followed and what are those management practices that leads to increase in soil organic carbon stock and what is the stock of soil organic carbon in the whole state. So in this case, you can see that this is soil map for the Madhya Pradesh. We'll mostly find in different types of soils and alluvial soils, deep medium black soils, mixed red and black soils, shallow and medium black soils. You can see this is from MPCST map we have taken, and based on that, this is the sampling points. You can say we have collected 15,054 samples from the state. And this sample collection was through our All India Coordinated Research Project on Micronutrients, Secondary Nutrients, and Heavy Metals. And from them, we got those points. And since agricultural soils, because it covers almost all types of soils, starting from forest soils or all over state Madhya Pradesh, we come down to less than 1% carbon, because most of the agricultural soils are less than 1%. Even I'll talk to you about that, how much carbon there in the Madhya Pradesh. But you can see those sampling points from 15,000, we come down around 10 to 11,000 samples here. And from those samples, we analyzed to find out what is the carbon map for the spread based on the wet digestion technique I was talking about. So from that, you can find that the around 50% soils are coming to be very low in soil organic carbon, and medium around 70%, high means, because this category is 0.5 to 0.75% organic carbon. Below 0.5%, it is low. And 0.5 to 0.75%, if the organic carbon content is there in the soil, it is medium, and greater than 0.75%, it is high. So based on that, this is the map we have developed. Then we developed, this is the surface concentration, means concentration of soil organic carbon in the top soil. But when you talk about the soil, usually we think of top 30 centimeter, because top 30 centimeter soils to be productive, because 75% of root growth, they are in the top 70% of the soil, surface soil. So that's why we went for again stock. Stock measurement, we did it through this concentration multiplied by bulk density of soil. Bulk density is, we follow a certain procedure to find out what is the bulk density of soil, then depth, and we find out the what is the stock. That stock in terms of tons per hectare, how much carbon there in the top 15 centimeter, then around the next layer, 15 to 30, so, and total stock about 0 to 30, top 30 centimeters. So we'd like that, we mapped for the whole state of Madhya Pradesh and find out which area of the state having more carbon, which area having less carbon. And we'll find that receiving the areas are receiving more rainfall, the eastern part of Madhya Pradesh and to the central part, despite they are having higher organic carbon content than western part and the northern part of Madhya Pradesh. So this is the one way we did it, and through irrigation grading techniques, we mapped those areas for the whole state of Madhya Pradesh. Then from this, then we try to find out what are those, we impose the different kinds of management practices, just like what type of crops we grow for this type of some soils. Just like in Kharif season, means rainy season, we grow soybean, then maize. Then in Rabi season, it's winter, you can see that recently wheat was harvested, wheat and chickpea, then other types of pulses also. But my presence will confine to maize, wheat, chickpea, this and soybean also. So these are most dominant crops for the state of Madhya Pradesh. You can see those, we only targeted those areas having agricultural practices. So we excluded those forest area as well as those urban areas for our calculations and estimation of soil organic carbon. And you can see when I talk about any management practices, and we see that if you follow certain management practices for years after years, there is every chance that the soil organic carbon may increase, but after certain years, it may come to the plateau. When it comes to the plateau under any management practices, but it takes certain year, and that plateau, we call it equilibrium calcium carbon concentration. That means that further following those management practices, we won't get increase in soil organic carbon. So here, in soybean wheat cropping system, we have followed NPK, means nitrogen, phosphorus, and potassium. That means these major nutrients, these essential nutrients, been applied ample quantity. That means a balanced fertilization. Apart from that also, we have added extra of five tons of farmyard manures per hectare. So this so that when you are, look at this top centimeter, when you balance fertilization, definitely after certain years, it comes to plateau. But when you add farmyard manures, means farmyard manures, it contains more carbon. That means you are adding extra carbon from external sources to the soil. So there is jump in carbon content. And you will see that not only the carbon concentration increases, but the time to reach plateau also, that year also increases. So Similarly, that is seeped in spectra, seeped in the line also in case of 15 to 30 centimeter. So this shows that when you follow certain management practices, having balanced fertilization, because you cannot feed the crop with suboptimal doses of any type of nutrients. Balance means you are giving it ample quantity according to need and according to the productivity. So in that case, that will reach plateau maybe 50, 60, 40, depends upon the types of soil, types of crops you are following. Once you reach that plateau, if you withdraw this management practice, definitely again, this value will come down. So once you follow this management practice, that means you'll find that this soil is having this capacity to reach this equilibrium of this much carbon concentration of this many years. So further increase is not possible. So based on this concept and principle, so we have analyzed the carbon stock, how much maximum carbon we can store on a particular cropping system and nutrient management practices for the state Madhya Pradesh. So you'll find that we have followed for maize in maize chickpea system. So you can see the maize yield. We map the whole state of different range of yields based on our balanced recommended dose of nitrogen, phosphorus, and potassium. Maize yield. In presence of in absence of FOIM, farmyard manures, as well as in presence of farmyard manures, and you'll see that when you add more carbon to the system, and not only it adds nutrient, but also adds carbon, and that is increase in crop yield. I'll present in different way later on why application of farmyard manures increases crop yield, because it increases carbon as well as it adds carbon to the soil, as well as adds nutrients to the soil also. Next is similarly for chickpea also, you can see that the chickpea yield under balanced fertilization and in balanced fertilization plus farmyard manures. And we call it integrated nutrient management. Integrated nutrient management means in addition to inorganic fertilizer, we are adding organic manures also. So integrated nutrient management is very much important, as well as we are encouraging farmers also to go for integrated nutrient management, because we have seen that from our long-term experiments of 45 years in different parts of India, that when you go for integrated nutrient management, not only you are improving the soil health, crop yield, but also the carbon content. So integrated nutrient management is very much important in this aspect. Similarly, you'll see also yield in maize wheat cropping system. In presence of FOIM, farmyard manures, as well as balanced fertilization. Similarly, you'll see the wheat yield also. So we have mapped for the whole state for different cropping system and nutrient management practices. Based on those cropping system and nutrient management practices, the equilibrium carbon concentration, then we map. You can see the equilibrium soil organic carbon concentration in balance, as well as the presence of farmyard manures. So you'll see that when there is presence of farmyard manures, you see this range. That means it has gone up. Soil carbon stock in the soil has gone up. And you can see those increase in the eastern part of Madhya Pradesh where it is more rainfall. So that is carbon conservation is beneficial in this region. Next is similarly, we also go two cropping systems. So that was maize chickpea and this is maize wheat system. And now we can see the stock means carbon, soil organic carbon stock in top 30 centimeter. Of soil, you can see where you have added maize wheat system in presence of farmyard manures. That means when we are going for only inorganic application, but when you add organic to that, that means integrated, that's farmyard manure, is every chance that the soil organic carbon stock is increasing. Similarly, in another cropping system also, when you go for farmyard manures, but you can go for also vermicompost or any type of compost, definitely it is going to increase the carbon content. That means any cropping system, not only the cropping system, improves the carbon content. You can see the different two cropping system, this cropping system giving more carbon, but side by side, it also presence of farmyard manure also improving the carbon content. Similarly, you can see the increase in yield also. Look at those increase in yield in presence of farmyard manures. So that means not only it increases carbon, but also it improves crop yield when you add organic matter or manures or compost in addition to your inorganic fertilizers. So based on that, we mapped the whole state Madhya Pradesh, and you can see, look at this soil wise, again, we differentiated this one soil wise, deep black soils, mixed red alluvials and shallow soils. you can see the soil organic stock for maize wheat cropping system and maize chickpea cropping system. You can see this NPK means balanced fertilization. When you add farm and manure in addition to that, there is increase in soil organic carbon stock. And different soils, it follows the similar trend in all types of soil that are in Madhya Pradesh and it's also in cropping system. Then another important thing we try to find out, this experiment is 45 years old experiment from Jabalpur. We have one experiment, a long-term fertility experiment, we call it. We try to find out what should be the optimum nitrogen application for wheat for maximum carbon sequestration. So look at this. We try to find out it comes to be 154 kilogram per hectare. So this is one type of innovation, you can say that we try to find out what should, but we usually don't apply that much nitrogen to wheat. We go for around 120 kilo nitrogen. Though the crop response is there to 150, but we don't go because of economics. Because when you increase 120 kilo to 150 kilo, the yield may increase, but it's not economically viable. But carbon doesn't see the economics, because it saw that with increasing nitrogen dose, your biomass production is increasing and crop yield is increasing, though not significant from the 120 kilogram, but it adds a lot of soil organic carbon to the soil through the roots and root exudates. That's why when you go for finding out the optimum nitrogen concentration for maximum carbon sequestration part of wheat, it comes to be 150 kilogram per hectare. Similarly, from that experiment also, I want to put this one in before you, just to say that when you apply for balanced fertilization, that means 100% balanced fertilization and integrated nutrient management. And this is suboptimal, means what, suppose you are adding 100 kilogram nitrogen, you are adding 50% means 50 kilo nitrogen. You are feeding the crop less. So when you are on 150% means you are feeding the crop more nutrient. But you can see that control means you didn't add anything for 45 years. That means that plot didn't receive anything. Only the crop was grown based on the available nutrient status from the soil. That means it's the inherent capacity of the soil to produce the crop. That is your soil fertility. That based on that, and we'll see that actually the crop was growing without crop, because just like your grasses grow, everywhere you will find when there is a shower of rain, because the soil having its inherent potential to supply nutrients, even if you don't add anything from external sources. Because our field crops needs more nutrients, because we need it economically, economic produce, that's why you add external sources. Otherwise, if you sow, the crop, the plant will grow and it will die also when the time comes. So in that case, you can see that how much carbon is sequestered per hectare per year, depending upon the type of treatment we are following for soybean wheat cropping system in Jabalpur. It is 45 years experiment, and we find that when you are adding farm and manure, you are adding 540 kilogram of carbon, 0.5 tons per hectare per year. Similarly, if you are not adding anything, still, since the plant is growing, so it adds a little bit of organic matter, it is very less. Even it is less than that, it's estimated value, but it may be less than that. But when you are adding nutrient and there's plant growth is there, there is every chance that carbon is sequestered in the system. And this is the time to reach that equilibrium. Remember, in the previous slide, I show you the plateau where actually when you follow certain management practices, it will go to a plateau, a position where that further application of a particular nutrient management practices will not increase the soil organic carbon. That's what actually the years to reach this. This is for black soils, but if you change the soil types, this value will change under similar management practice. It may not, because the cropping system may change, soil texture may change, soil types may change, and this value may be 30, 40, 50 years, it may be 60 years, depending upon the crop and the soil types. Then I want to show you a little bit about climate change impact we have studied based on whatever I showed you, which is the present value, how much we can increase if you follow that. But in the context of climate change, because climate change was not considered in type of modeling activities or simulations, but here we are considering only one aspect of climate change, that's in mid-century, 2050, under RCPs, means Representative Consultation Pathways of 4.5. how the carbon will behave, or whether there is a chance that carbon increase or decrease. If it is increase, how much? If decrease, how much? So we found that it's mixed balance. There are certain cases increases, certain cases decreases. But I'll show you how it worked. So these are the actually for the central India. But you can say that what and I guess by this time you know what is RCPs and different time slices. It's based on GCM, general circulation models. Of around 15 to 20 models were used for this downscaling this data, and we got this data, and we expect that in Madhya Pradesh, that is in future climate, that is increase in rainfall. If you look at this change in precipitation, means rainfall increases there. So we are expecting more and more rain in our future climate scenarios. And what are the temperature? Temperature also going to increase. So we expect that because we are targeting 2050, we are expecting at around 1.9 degree increase in temperature having 500 ppm carbon dioxide concentration under RCP 4.0. And your precipitation increase will be around 6%. That 6% average, that can be, you know, much more rain in a short period of time. And that will be too difficult for us to handle unless otherwise you follow certain conservation ethics practices, conservation of or recycling of rainwater. So this we are targeting based on this. We went for only a few soils, black soils, because if you remember the map, this period total black soil belts, medium and deep black soils in this region. So we try to find out how much carbon is going to increase or decrease. It's surprising to see that, as I mentioned you, when you follow certain management practices under a particular cropping system, there is always increase in soil carbon. It's come to plateau. And we can see that increases from 0.5 to 0.6. So baseline means this is what we are following now. But when you go to RCP 4.5, where we increase the temperature by 1.9 degree and carbon dioxide concentration by 500 ppm for this soybean system, you will be surprised to see that there is not much decrease in soil carbon. Because two things comes into play here. One is carbon dioxide, next is temperature. And temperature, you know that it has negative impact on crops. Anybody, because increased temperature is not favorable to anyone. Similarly, it is not favorable to crops also. But side by side, when it is talking about carbon dioxide, in that case, increasing carbon dioxide concentration, it favors the plant growth. We call it fertilizing effect of carbon dioxide. So C3 or C4 plants, depends upon the types of plants, they respond to the increasing carbon dioxide concentration. So C3 plant, they respond around 600 or 700 ppm, but C4 plants, they may go as high as 900 or 800, 800, 900 ppm of carbon dioxide. So this carbon dioxide ppm of 500 ppm, that must have favored the soybean wheat crop, the growth has increased. That's why increasing carbon dioxide is sometimes is offset the negative impact of temperature. So in the interaction of carbon dioxide temperature, that might have affect the crop yield. But in another also, but major system, there was slight decline, though it is not significant in this case, though normal case, because as you know, you follow certain management practice, it will increase, but temperature increase with carbon dioxide increase in concentration, still there is decline in major system, but we didn't see in soybean wheat as well as MHP system. That means it shows that when you add anything legume to the system, it becomes more resilient to climate change. Maize root system, both are cereals, but maize chickpea, means your Bengal gram or gram, that actually is a different cropping system. So it shows different phenomenon, and that's what actually the carbon concentration decline is less in that case. So we'll again come to this because I'm coming to the last part of my presentation. What are those soil management practices we should follow to boost soil organic carbon? So I have certain examples, though in India we have plenty of examples. I have also shown you examples if you follow the management practices just like cropping system or nutrients. So definitely you are going to increase the carbon content that already you saw in my previous slides. But I'm showing you some examples. Adopting agricultural practices to conserve soil organic carbon. Those agricultural practices which conserve soil organic carbon. That means that organic that management practices could be your adding more manures to the system, or what you are seeing nowadays, burning of wheat residue, but you don't burn. If you leave the residue in the surface and through suitable management practices, we call it conservation agricultural practices, if you follow that principle, definitely you are going to increase the carbon. So it has been seen that conserving soil organic carbon can increase crop productivity, soybean, maize, and wheat by 17.5 megatons per year. So it has been estimated that once you conserve the carbon, you are increasing the crop yield. Similarly, 1 ton of increasing soil organic carbon pool degraded the crop, any degraded cropland can increase wheat yield by 20 to 40 kg per hectare and other crops also. So that means how carbon help in building, not only building soil fertility, but also increasing crop yield. Similarly, so one concept is green manure. I know you are all engineers, you might have been knowing, but green manure means any crop, the leaves and the whole plant is also added to the soil. So they add carbon. And it has been seen that such techniques could bring soil carbon to 17 gigatons worldwide if you follow. But not many people follow this nowadays, but still it should be followed in the present context of climate change when you see that carbon improving soil organic carbon can mitigate the negative impact of climate change. And most important is agroforestry system, where agriculture and forestry goes together. This system is most productive system so far sequestration of carbon is concerned. It's been estimated that 7 tons of carbon per hectare per year can be sequestered through this process. And next is combined application of manures with chemical fertilizers, that we call it integrated nutrient management. I presented also some slides from Jabalpur. So can lead to 43% higher organic carbon. Those they have seen in China and in India also, we have seen all our agricultural soils from all experiments, all India coordinated research projects and long-term fertilizer trials in around 25 universities, agriculture university in India. We have seen that integrated nutrient management improves the soil organic carbon. So thank you very much. And thank you very much for giving me opportunity. So this is the end of my presentation. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir. I would like to request all the participants, if you are having any query, you may raise your hand or you may post in the chat box.
Yes, please.
And who is this? Jitesh, are you there? Ravi, Pratik?
Pratik is in another meeting, ma'am.
Okay, Ravi, is there? Who is there?
Nobody, ma'am. Only me.
Jitesh?
Yeah.
I'm not able to see their hands. So anyone who has the question, okay.
I know they are all engineers. This is a different subject for them.
Yes, sir, it is very relevant. If we are talking about the climate change, we can't neglect this topic.
Yes, you are right. Because this actually whole agriculture system, it can be source, it can be sink, as I mentioned. So we always try to make it sink rather than source. So we always use advanced techniques to measurement, or just like ADCO variance techniques, we say that from that instrument we can say that whether your system is carbon negative or carbon positive. So the most important is that what type of management practice we follow and what type of crops we're following and cropping system and what techniques you are using, because we need always for such type of research advanced techniques. So advanced techniques are most important because they help us to, you know, give more details about the particular system.
Okay. So because we deliberately we have included this topic of soil organic carbon, because nowadays we are talking about the new technologies like IoT, artificial intelligence. Yes, yes. For the application of this area needs to be understood by the engineers also.
Yes, actually that's there for engineers, you know, remote sensing approaches, because that's also most important one. Because your school of environment and all, they are working. So I have shown the soil organic carbon sequestration process. You will see that I have mentioned one near infrared and mid infrared spectroscopy. Actually, we are using those techniques to estimate soil organic carbon. We can go to the field directly, you can take, or you can bring the sample to the lab. You can also use that technique. Even through remote sensing approaches to satellite also, you can map whole country. So, and once you get the map done and you can use the modeling, advanced modeling technique, you can find the whole profile soil organic carbon. Once the surface is done, there is a procedure we can make whole profile carbon content. So this technique is also good for engineers, I can say that. And they can help us, you know, in this regard. So in remote sensing application particularly. And others, of course, all instruments are engineering techniques, all engineers, they have developed those instruments. So engineering is always important because so far advanced techniques are concerned. आपका म्यूट हो गया मैम.
One participant has posted to me that I am not so much aware about the soil management, but it helps me to improve interest in soil management.
Yes, thank you so much. Yes, because I know it's all engineers, but you know, without agriculture, what will be, because agriculture is there. So if I want to say one line, our late Prime Minister Jawaharlal Nehru once said, everything can wait, but not agriculture, because it fits the nation. So if, just like corona in the COVID-19, you see everything stuck, but our agriculture policy, you always get food, you always get vegetables, because farmers are there, they are working, they can't stop. If they stop, means you'll be hungry. So everything can wait, but not agriculture. So it's a continuous process. We have been doing it for 1,000 years now, and we'll do it. Without this, it is not possible. So since it will continue for years to come, so every management practices, whatever we follow, definitely that actually impact our environment, that also change our climate, that also change our water cycle. So all management practices lead to greenhouse gas emissions like methane, nitrous oxide, because we are adding a lot of fertilizer. So in that case, we are expecting nitrous oxide emission, and nitrous oxide is 300 times more potential as greenhouse gas, no potential, than carbon dioxide. So 300 times, little bit concentration of nitrous oxide is more potent. No, it's more dangerous than carbon dioxide. So definitely when you are adding, you know, India is a big country. We are having 141 million hectare cultivated area. In that million hectare, we are adding lots of thousand tons of nitrogenous fertilizer. We are expecting nitrous oxide emission also. On different, so agriculture is a source, but we want to make it, you know, sink through our better management practices. That's what actually we have been working for so many years now. So what should be the best, and we have observed that. That's what the presentation was all about, the what type of management practice the farmers should follow, and so that we can make the agriculture carbon sink, not carbon source, carbon dioxide sink, not carbon dioxide source.
One more question I got from the Suvir. He's asking, how do soil properties impact mitigation of emerging contaminants like nanomaterials, pharmaceutical compounds?
How does soil properties? Of course, because any materials, because soil is a buffer. You add anything to it, it will absorb, because it doesn't complain. If it's a living entity, but it doesn't complain, it's a buffer. So it has having high capacity to absorb many things. And it also, when you add anything to soil, it's the soil solution most important. Those chemicals that are soluble in soils, that may contaminate. But still, if they are biodegradable, the microbes present in the soil, that's what, without microbes cannot think of the world. That's what I told in the very beginning. So without microbes, they may degrade, you know, that some of the chemicals may be biodegradable. They can be, you know, decomposed and formed another compound of easily, maybe a long long chain reaction formula, maybe simple sugar, simple amino acid, something. So that may be formed. But if that is not formed, if they are not biodegradable, that becomes pollutant. If they are biodegradable, definitely this will come to another form which are not poisonous, which are not polluting our soil or our environment or water bodies, then that is a chance. But carbon having, you know, carbon also presents, also it acts as a filter to the soil water also, I told you once. And it also presence of those carbon pumps complexes, because it has been so many compounds, you know, so many functional groups. So it has so many charge, negative charge sites. And that helps, because its cation exchange capacity is very high. And that helps absorbing some heavy metals. So presence of your carbon definitely attracts those heavy metals and binding, we call it chelating. It forms a chelate. It forms a compound which it won't allow to release to the soil. So That's why it reduces the pollution level, presence of your carbon also.
Okay, sir. Thank you so much, sir. This is Suvir Dubey here from Indore Institute of Science and Technology, Indore.
So okay.
It was a really, sir, highly informative, sir.
Thank you.
Thank you so much, sir.
Welcome. Most welcome. If you have any questions.
Yes, ma'am. Thank you. Good afternoon, sir.
Good afternoon.
Yes, sir. This soil sequestration is something new to me because we have heard of forest acting as a sink for carbon dioxide.
Yes.
But then soil alone can sequester carbon is really very surprising. And it's good to hear that soil can act also as a sink for CO2.
Yes.
But sir, the thing is, to what depth does soil sequester carbon? Because in one of your slides, I saw it was top 30 centimeter.
Yes. Yes, actually, why top 30 centimeter? I mentioned that also because 75, because when you talk about agriculture, we talk about the crop plants. What crops we are taking? So most of the plants, those cultivated, we are cultivating, except the deep-rooted like tur or arar, they're going deeper. Otherwise, others just live in the 75% of their root zones are in the top 30 centimeters. But sequestration can be at the low depth because we also develop a concept. We want also the soil to be sequestered at the low depth. We want to trap soil below 30 or 45 or 60 centimeters so that it will not expose to the atmosphere. You know that once the carbon compound is exposed, that means the presence of moisture as well as temperature, then decomposition process, microbes start eating it. So decomposition process starts and carbon dioxide will be released. But once it's trapped deeper part of the profile, that's why those carbon which are there in the deeper part of the profile, they are stored and sequestered forever. Unless otherwise we go for deep plowing, we don't go for excavation, expose those subsoil, then there is a chance. Otherwise, it will be there. So that concept is because I presented only 30 centimeter, but so far carbon sequestration concerned, we always go for 1 meter depth because we want to see that. That's why one slide I have shown 3 meter depth also. It considers both organic as well as inorganic. But I am more concentrating on organic one. So organic one, because where rainfall is high, if you don't have carbonates or bicarbonates in the soil, then we don't talk much about soil inorganic carbon. But arid regions like Rajasthan or maybe Western UP, maybe Haryana, Punjab, where you can find, you know, inorganic carbon contents are more than the organic because of carbonates, bicarbonates, calcium, sodium, potassium, magnesium. This is what actually the concept is. But I presented 30 centimeters just according to my own convenience, I can say. But justifying that my root zone is within 75%, you know, with that.
And deserts, even deserts can do this.
Yes.
Without trees, even deserts can act as a sink for CO2.
It is always
always there. That's good, sir.
But there are different process starts actually.
Okay.
So that different process will start because vegetation will be less. Don't bicarbonate, they are serve as the sink for carbon dioxide. Through different processes. This process will not act. There will be different process for them.
Thank you, sir. My domain is actually chemistry.
Oh,
so it was very interesting, sir. It was a very interesting topic, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Thank you, sir.
मैम आपका साफ फिर म्यूट हो गया
सॉरी सर सर वन मोर क्वेश्चन फ्रॉम मिस्टर दुष्यंत तिवारी ही इज आस्किंग हाउ द बर्निंग ऑफ क्रॉप रेसिड्यू इफेक्ट द सॉइल्स ऑर्गेनिक कार्बन क्वालिटी
ओके सॉइल ऑर्गेनिक कार्बन क्वालिटी ओके डेफिनेटली व्हेन यू बर्न सम अमाउंट शुड्स कम टू द एटमॉस्फेयर सम कार्बन डाइऑक्साइड आल्सो लॉस्ट थ्रू बर्निंग But still, you can see those black, you know, you can say those ash that are in the soil. But so far as quality is concerned, definitely there will be loss in the quality because those black matters, you can say those ash, may not be eaten by the microbes very easily, you know, because there's no nitrogen there because it's just carbon and the carbon may be inert sometimes. But we target also inert one. So when you talk about biochar also, through the process of burning also, that pyrolysis might have done in some parts of that, you know, burning process. Because it's not that only 100 degrees Celsius or something will be there. There will be 200, 300 degrees in some zone. some zone of burning. So in that case also, you expect that some biochar might have formed, which are more inert and resistant material. So that will also go to the soil organic carbon. But quality-wise, I can say, okay, that adds something to the inert part of the material. So that will improve, but we lost significant amount through burning. That otherwise would have been added to the soil system. Because of burning, we lost significant amount. Only maybe 10%, 15% is added. 80-90% may have lost as carbon dioxide, you know, soot matter, maybe some other forms.
Thank you, sir. Dr. Kapadia, your mic is on. Do you have some question? Dr. Kapadia is there? I think so, by mistake, she on it. Yeah. Sir, one more question is there. How to improve the soil bearing capacity by using soil carbon assessment?
Okay, because just like our soil health assessment, you might be knowing Government of India, MP government, everybody is talking about how to improve soil health. So definitely it is one indicator of soil health. So carbon content is more means you expect other nutrients, because presence of carbon actually it influences the nutrient cycling process in the soil. And the nutrient cycling process, when I talk about the essential nutrients, not all the nutrient elements that you study in your physics chemistry classes. No, it is the essential nutrients like nitrogen, phosphorus, potassium, calcium, magnesium, copper, iron, manganese, zinc, molybdenum, boron. These are all. So this process, the presence of carbon, that helps in, you know, availability of those nutrients. So indirectly or directly, it is so health is improved. So carbon is more means is the nutrients are better recycled or cycling process is going up, and microbes are alive. As you know, the without carbon source of food, because carbon serves as carbohydrate for them. So microbes will not survive with the presence. So you'll find that when there is less carbon, you'll get less number of bacteria, fungi, or maybe beneficial, maybe not beneficial, but their population will decline and soil biodiversity will be lost. So this is also one important, that the biodiversity is maintained due to the presence of organic matter. So it makes soil healthy.
I think questions are not much there. Are no more questions?
Yes, please.
I would like to convey here that because engineering is, can't engineers or technologists, they can't be work in the lab. All the engineering technology is for the application in the field or for the common people. So we can't segregate that we are not actually, able.
Whatever I said is the integration of everything. Your part is there because instrumentation part is yours. If I am a scientist, I work. Definitely, I need something. You talk about IoT, maybe you talk about ICT, you may talk about a drone application. I want to have a camera fitted to the drone or aerial unmanned vehicles. So everything, your application is there. Only thing is that we have to bring the problem to you, having some concept in our mind, and talk to you and see that I want to develop this type of instruments, maybe a sensor. So you help us. So and engineer, then that case, engineer will go to the lab and develop that for us. So, and we are apply most of the things we are doing applied parts. Whatever I showed, this is applied. But basic part is, we are doing also some basic work. But this will be the basic work if I go to you and through some processes and with some concept in my mind to develop something. Definitely, I will bring engineers to lab for developing a sensor for me. And we have MOU with GPV. And we are expecting very soon some degree of, involvement in our process. So it is already done, actually. We are waiting for the fund, I guess. And once it's done, so definitely RGPB and we will be working together for development of some sensors.
Well, I would like to have a request that RGPB has adopted 5 villages under Unnat Bharat Abhiyan.
Very good.
So nearby villages, okay. Actually hardly 10 to 15 kilometer distance. Mm-hmm. So definitely if soil sciences can help us, our farmers. So it is, we are having the MOU also.
Yes, yes.
So we can jointly work, yes, for the farmers by improving the soil health.
Of course. Because we are also having in our Meragaon, Meragaurav, in that program, we have adopted 55 villages. We also go there now, COVID time, so we have not visited. So we go there and listen to the farmers. We also work with them. And we also having we are also having so many programs, farmers, scientists interaction, and then some many forms of program, different types. So in that case also, if you want to bring take us to your villages, and if you can bring the problems to us to solve their problems, then definitely we are there to help, because we are there for this community only, farming community. So those related to natural resource management, related to soil health management, definitely our institute is more than capable of doing that actually. So we are ready for that. Not only me, we have teams, you know, team comprising of 5 scientists, 6 scientists, having 10 teams actually. We have 60 scientists, 55 scientists have adopting 55 villages. So we are there actually. So definitely you will help us, and without MOU also, because this is our job, our duty. So our director or we should don't deny this, and we are ready and we are always available. So we will help, definitely we will help.
Thank you so much, sir. Because we lake in this area for to support the farmer, because I am from Energy Environment Department. So we used to support only in the area of renewable energy. We have installed the solar power plants.
Yes,
so we are working in the area of making these villages energy efficient, yes, with the support of Urja Vikas Nigam Limited. But definitely, yes, I want to involve this EO department and agriculture department, yes, so that we can support our adopted villages in a better way.
Of course. Sure. Why not? We are ready. Thank you.
Thank you so much, sir, for a wonderful presentation. It's a very good presentation. It's definitely all the faculty of different disciplines got the new perspective on the new area of climate change. So thank you so much for giving us the time.
So thank you very much for giving me opportunity to talk to you and discuss the matter, and talking to the faculty members. I know this is different altogether topic, but I hope they must have got something they are not used to. So I'm really obliged and grateful to you inviting me for this webinar. Thank you so much.
Yeah, thank you, sir. Namaskar, sir.
Thank you.
I would like to inform all participants. Now we are having the session. This tomorrow we are having the online examination, so we can take this time. From last 4 to 5 days, you are listening us only. So we would like to listen all the our participants. We would like to know their feedbacks. So you may raise your hand one by one. You can share your experience, your input. We would like to listen your inputs. So I would request all the participants to share your experience one by one, because we all belong to different discipline. And this topic of climate change is definitely we planned to involve all the streams, all the especially the mechanical, civil, electrical, chemical, which are more close to this area of climate change. So it's my humble request. We would definitely like to listen to all of you one by one, because tomorrow we are having very short of time, so we would not be able to listen to everyone.
Hello, good evening, ma'am.
Who's there?
Okay, I'm Dr. Anupa Mandloi from Aurobindo College, Indore.
Okay, so what we will do, are you able to see the tab of raise hand? Are you all able to see? Okay, then by when you can raise hand if possible, and we will unmute one so that it will be easy for us to listen to each and everyone. Anup ji, Jitesh, okay, Vijaya ji, Anup ji, Anupam Mandloi ji. So okay, we will start with Anupam ji.
Okay, good evening, ma'am.
Good evening. So Baba, you can share about your institute and about your discipline, and then about the program. Okay.
I am Dr. Anupa Mandloi from Sri Aurobindo Institute of Technology, Indore. I am working there as associate professor in Engineering Chemistry department, and we have projects related to environment chemistry with Civil Engineering department also. That is the effluent water treatment and all. And I am taking subjects that is chemistry, environment. So that is why I have joined this particular course, because it is more related to environment and analysis of water. That is the input water, drinking water, and the output water, effluent water. So this particular training is very helpful for me. And we just have so many topics and ideas here, so that we can use this as a project for a civil engineering student in their major project in the final year. This is my opinion. Right, ma'am?
Thank you, Anupam ji. So next is Vijaya ji. So I would like to again repeat that we will share, you will share your name, institute, and then your discipline, and then how this climate change program has benefited you and will benefit you further in your work. Okay, so Vijaya ji, okay, I have to unmute. Jitesh, can you unmute Vijaya ji?
Thank you. Yeah, good evening. Good evening, everybody. This is Dr. Menon from Corporate Group. I'm from the Department of Chemistry, and from the past 10 years, I've been very closely related to climate change, because I have quite an interaction with Mr. Lokendra Thakkar, because he stays quite close to me. So we actually discuss a lot about these things, and basically because I am of chemistry, so the interest lies to that part. Ma'am, this webinar was really very good for me. I attended each and every session, except the first session I couldn't attend fully because I got a bit late. Naming adaptation, I could see the difference between mitigation and adaptation, you know, because we hear that what it meant. Now, in future, if I talk to my students, I talk to my peers, at least I can tell them what mitigation is. Ms. Rashi's and Mr. V.K. Sethi's carbon capture and sequestration was very helpful. Mr. Manish Kumar's green building concept was really good. Mr. Saransh Vajpayee's mitigation strategies for MP,